This item just into the San Jose News Center. A San Jose man has been sentenced to 1 to 25 years for kidnapping, 15 years to life for armed robbery.
A 25-year-old drug offender has drawn a six-month-to-life term in state prison for stabbing a fellow inmate at the Santa Clara County Jail.
Every day of the year, 20,000 men and women are jailed in California state prisons, 25,000 in county jails. Hundreds of millions are spent yearly to run California's jails and prisons, the largest system in the entire country. Those who make it out of prison alive return to the streets. Within 4 years, two-thirds will be rearrested. Tonight, KNTV, Channel 11, examines the prison system as we take you behind bars and beyond.
This will be at 10:50 on a 314. It's with a suspect. 5600 Cottle Road at Blossom Hill.
Last May, this pharmacy in the city of Campbell was the scene of an attempted armed robbery. The owner of the pharmacy, Steve Carusa, describes what happened.
It was a Monday afternoon. This man and woman had come into the store. They browsed for just a minute. They came over to this counter. My daughter had asked them if there was anything that she could help them with. They said no. The man pulls a gun out from behind his shirt and tells us all to get into the back room. My son and I were in the back area over here. We were all told to lie down on the floor, and we were lying down diagonally in the back. He started to tape up our hands, and as he was taping up my hand behind my back, he said, "I don't care if I blast you all away, because I've spent so much time in the pen that if they ever catch me, that they'll put me away forever." Well, this made me quite angry and frightened at the same time. He started to loot the drugs out of the drug locker. Meanwhile, the girl had gone over to the register and was getting the money out of the register. I became very frightened about what he had said. This is my family, and I was afraid he was really going to hurt us. As he bent over, he was putting the drugs into a box that he had on the floor. He bent over, he had the gun in his right hand, and I came off the floor, and I put a block right into his backside, and I hit his head into this prescription counter. It knocked him down onto the floor here. The gun hand hit this counter, and the gun had fallen out of his hand. I was fighting with him down on the floor. My son had broken away from his tape and had grabbed the gun with both hands and was holding him down with one knee and was pointing the gun toward the girl, who was down on the floor and digging into her purse. I reached over and grabbed her by the hair, pulled her down on the floor, and held them both down. Meanwhile, my daughter had phoned the police. She had broken away from her tape, phoned the police, and they were here within a minute.
This is Arlen Adams, the man Carusa described in the attempted robbery. Adams is 40 years old, a native of Oakland. Most who know him call him Shadow. For 20 of the last 22 years, Adams has lived behind bars. You could say Adams is a typical con. He comes from a broken home and never finished high school. At age 2, his parents were divorced, and for the next 15 years, his home changed repeatedly. At age 16, feeling alienated, he started using drugs, a habit he was never capable of shaking for very long. A great deal of money is needed to maintain a drug habit, and Adams, like most drug addicts, was forced into the world of crime to support his habit. Adams was never a very good criminal. His first arrest was in San Francisco for burglary. He was 20 years old. The court gave him probation. A year later, he was arrested again for burglary. He served 5 years at Folsom and San Quentin. That prison sentence was the first for Adams and started him down the road to prison institutionalization, a term used to describe those who become dependent and submissive to the prison system, unable to cope on the outside. Upon his release, he sought employment. An ex-con with little education has a slim chance of finding a job. Adams reverted back to heroin to block the pain of being shut out of society. Within the month, he was rearrested and sent back to prison. Starting in 1956, Adams served time in Folsom, San Quentin, Soledad, Susanville, Vacaville, Sierra, and Chino. Since 1956, he's only been on the streets for 2 years. The majority of those who are sent to prison, like Adams, will be back time and time again. Why doesn't being sent to prison deter one from committing crimes?
After you get in for a while in prison, you don't stop. You don't start thinking about quit crime. You don't think of anything else. You don't think about other ways. You don't think about becoming a productive member of society. You don't think about all those things. You get in there and you get to doing your time, and then when it comes time to get out, you get out, and things happen. Wind back, like in my case, you just wind up right back in, you know, a few months, a month, two later. There's no rehabilitation in prison. I mean, you rehabilitation comes within. You know, you have to want, you know, to rehabilitate yourself. You have to want to stop doing this. You have to want to another way of life.
While an inmate's in prison, he's cut off from his family and friends. He loses his sense of freedom and dignity. He loses his perspective on reality. The life he leads is one of mental stagnation.
You know, you go in 19, 20 years old, and I think for 10 years or so, you're still at the same place when you came in. You know, you're still 20 years old. You're still thinking like a 20-year-old person. Your actions are the same way. And pretty soon you're 30 years old. And then, like in my case, I'm 40 years old. And a lot of times you don't wake up till you're 40 years old. But, you know, the lines start coming. Jesus, you look in the mirror one day and you say, I better straighten my act up.
After spending so many years in prison, coping in the outside world can be traumatic.
Since I went, after 20 years, I went and got a driver's license, and it was a big deal to me. It was like, I was bragging, I guess, a little bit, running around telling everybody, and people were looking at me like I was crazy. Hey, I just got a driver's license, you know? And I guess they couldn't understand it. But I go to the employment office. This time, as long as I stayed out, and I went to the employment office, and that was kind of a bad scene too, because when you make out the applications and everything, and then I go for an interview, and the woman tells me, "What have you done for the past 20 years?" You know, I said, "Well, I haven't did anything. I've been in prison." She said, "Oh, I see." You know, and then they don't. Something happens there, you know, something happens to your interview.
When Adams was released from prison in 1974, he remained out for over a year, the longest time he spent on the streets in the last 22 years. Adams stayed off drugs for 9 months, and he married. This is Adams' wife, Barbara. She's a secretary during the day and a drug counselor in the evenings. Barbara feels it will be difficult to keep her marriage together now that her husband's imprisoned. She says the prison system is the key barrier.
The institution itself just makes you feel terrible the minute you get there. The looks of it, the amount of time you spend getting into the place, all the different screening situations you have to go through to get in there. The time that you spend waiting for them to find somebody who's sitting in their cell waiting for them to come and get them. And it's an all day from before daybreak to after dark situation. And they make it impossible just about. They talk to the visitors like they're an inmate, you know, all right, line up and to keep in a straight line and don't talk. And, you know, and I'm not an inmate, I'm a free person. And I don't appreciate being treated like one. I've gone down institutions and had to be strip searched and things like this. And these kind of things are just very degrading.
Are you going to miss them?
Well, I do miss them. I felt very, very, very lost when he left. I felt like part of me had died. He was gone. And, when you know that someone is going to be gone that long and it's so hard to get to see them and get to talk to them, you have to, you start trying to protect your own feelings and you start withdrawing. And most relationships don't make it.
When we filmed our interview with Arlen Adams at the Santa Clara County Jail, he was awaiting re-entry into California's prison system. The first stop for Adams will be the Vacaville Medical Facility, 40 miles northeast of San Francisco. Vacaville is the distribution center for the Department of Corrections. At Vacaville, the decision is reached as to which prison an inmate will serve his time. For Adams, it could be Folsom, near Sacramento, a medieval-looking institution housing the older convict. Or Soledad, meaning solitude in Spanish, a medium maximum security prison located south of Salinas. It could be San Quentin, north of San Francisco, the oldest and most notorious of California's prisons. Whichever of the 12 institutions Adams is sent to, the treatment he receives will be similar in nature. He will lead a life of strict regimentation. Essentially, all decisions are made for him. When to awaken, when to eat, when to work, when to sleep. For his wife, visitation will be difficult, if not impossible. If she does visit, there will be time limitations and virtually no privacy. They will have to talk and touch, crowded into a large hall with guards watching constantly. The Arlen Adams episode is just one story. There are 20,000 inmates in California's prisons. The annual cost to run the prisons is $225 million, or nearly $10,000 per inmate, and the costs are going up. The Department of Corrections predicts by 1980 it will cost $325 million to run the system. The object of the Department of Corrections is to punish and control those who break the law, and they do their job very well. But there's a price to pay. Not only do we pay hundreds of millions to maintain the system, we pay when inmates are released onto the streets with $200 in their pockets and basically no place to go. We pay because the inmate will find it so difficult to find work, he will burglarize your home or rob your store in order to survive. Then you will pay again. He will be caught, eventually, and sent back to prison. It will cost $10,000 a year to keep him there. Then he will return to the streets once again, and the cycle will be repeated. To truly understand the prison system and how it operates, you must go inside the institution itself. We chose San Quentin, described as the melting pot of California's prison system. Q, as it's called by the inmates, was originally built on the shores of San Francisco Bay back in 1852. Most of the structures you see today were built around the turn of the century. Within San Quentin is a subculture of violence. It's been described as insanity, sickness, grotesque. Nearly everyone, including the Department of Corrections, believes San Quentin is antiquated and should be closed down.
San Quentin, I hate every inch of you. You cut me and you scarred me through and through. And I'll walk out a wiser, weaker man. Mr. Congressman, you can't understand. What good do you think you do? Do you think I'll be different when you're through? You bend my heart and mind and you warp my soul. Your stone walls turn my blood a little cold.
This is Jimmy Littoral. He's been in and out of state prisons now for the past 14 years. He's now in the protective custody wing of San Quentin State Prison. Jimmy, can you tell me why you're in the PC unit?
Yeah, well, I got stabbed, and they didn't know who did it, and they asked me, and I couldn't tell them, because I don't know who did it. And so instead of putting me out on the main line where I might retaliate and where the guy might try to stick me again or, like, I might try to stick him, they said, well, we'll just put him in his protective custody unit,
And where have you been stabbed?
Well, I got stabbed up here through the arm.
Up here through the... Back here?
Yeah.
Over here?
Yeah.
Back there?
Yeah, and I got stuck here and back here.
Back here? Back there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Jimmy was picked at random. Someone being stabbed in prison is almost a daily occurrence. Another problem in San Quentin and other California jails and prisons is homosexual rape. Aggressive men denied sexual contact with women turn to homosexuality for sexual release. Often the weaker men in the prison, known as punks, become victims of violent homosexual rape. Protesting the victimization can lead to a knifing. Although the torturous procedure of solitary confinement, where men were thrown naked into cement rooms with only a hole on the floor, has basically ended, being locked down for long periods of time in cells no wider than the stretch of your arms continues.
You're in here for five to life, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Tell me, how often are you let out of this cell?
About once a day. Not every day. Some days they have some high security wrist out, and some people that they don't want me or anyone else around. So on those days, I'm not let out.
When they do let you out, how long are you let out for?
A maximum of 1 hour. Well, between 20 minutes and 1 hour.
If we maintain those same conditions in our zoos for an animal the size of a man, you would hear loud and vocal protests from the community. But the public demands harsh punishment for lawbreakers, and because prisons are in desolate locations, we're not aware of the dismal conditions. One Department of Corrections official told me the best we can expect from the system is that those imprisoned will come out no worse than when they entered. And when they are released, they face the stigma of being a convict.
Although it is possible for an inmate to gain a high school diploma here and some basic college, he is not prepared to go out on the streets and deal with the discrimination that the society in general harbors towards him. I say this in terms of the private sectors of the community as well as the state and federal civil service.
So when you get back out on the street, there's basically nothing for you to do. There's no jobs. There's no way that you can make it in society.
No, sir.
So what happens?
Well, if you have enough determination to try to get out and stay out to complete your parole and to try to gain some type of employment to keep you from coming back, if you're successful in doing this, well and good. If you are not, then you're going to be on your way back.
And they do come back, over and over again. The FBI's figures show two-thirds of those who have committed felonies will be rearrested within 4 years of their release from prison. You would think being locked up within the bleak surroundings of prison, the inmate would want to get out and stay out forever. But the prison system leaves scars. A member of the Prisoners Union in San Francisco told me, a man enters prison with larceny on his mind. He leaves with murder in his heart. When back on the street with no money, friends and family gone, the anger he feels is released in the criminal act, and we all pay a price. But if prison isn't the answer, what is? What do we do with the men and women who commit murder, who rob your homes and businesses, who assault people? One possible answer can be found in the Pacific Heights District of San Francisco. This is the headquarters of the Delancey Street Foundation, housed in what used to be the old Russian consulate. Delancey Street was founded 6 years ago by three ex-drug addicts and ex-cons. It all started in one room. Today, over 350 people call Delancey Street their home. Most live in this apartment building near Golden Gate Park and in this apartment complex in Sausalito. 90% of the residents are either ex-drug users or ex-cons. This is Charlie Smith. He's from Chicago. An ex-drug addict, he spent 20 years of his life behind bars for drug busts and burglaries. He was probated by the courts to Delancey Street 5 years ago and became one of the founders.
Charlie, can you just briefly explain to me what Delancey Street is?
Well, Delancey Street is a rehabilitation, educational program where people come in to get their lives together. It's a hard place. It's harder than prison because here you got to really do some things for yourself, and there you got people constantly telling you you should go to school, telling you you should treat ladies like ladies, you should respect yourself and respect others, you should go to school, you should learn a trade.
Now, how does Delancey Street help people to become, let's say, productive members of society?
We have encounter sessions 3 nights a week, and in there we talk to him about his shortcomings, what he's done to his life, what he's done to his family, and lay it out clearly to him. We don't listen to the sob story. He said, well, the reason why I did this is because my mom broke up with my dad, or I did this, or I had this, or I got to have some Thorazine to be able to talk. We tell him, no, you don't need that. And we talk the kind of language that they understand. Since there's no professional people in the foundation, and we all have been through, we all can relate to the problems that one is having when he walks in.
But the key to Delancey Street's success can be summed up in one word, work. The foundation is totally self-supporting, and income is derived through the various businesses developed in the last 6 years. The foundation owns a restaurant in the posh Union Street District, which trains people about the restauranting business, an automotive garage and body shop which maintains foundation vehicles, as well as serving the public. It also functions as a school. There's a construction company that builds for the foundation and contracts out. Again, the business functions as a school. In the warehouse district of the city, a plant and glassware business is operated, which teaches foundation members skills they can use once they leave. Delancey Street also runs an accredited high school located in the old Russian consulate. It serves young people, residents of Delancey Street. This is Bill Despoyans from San Jose. He's worked at various foundation businesses since coming to Delancey Street 2 years ago. Bill spent 6 years in prison for drug-related burglaries and robberies. He talks freely about his prison experience.
Well, prison had a twofold effect. One, it left me very emasculated in the kind of decisions that I would have to make. That was taken completely away from me, even to the point of what time you get up, what you do during the day, and I had no freedom of choice to make. So naturally I became very undisciplined and very hostile.
But coming to Delancey Street has made dramatic changes in Bill's life. He tells us how.
you end up developing some discipline, some self-respect for yourself. You find out who you really are. And, of course, this opens up, like, new horizons for you. Your perspectives are broadened, and you find yourself, instead of being emasculated, being able to develop your own potential, standing on your own feet. Well, what it really is you become an adult. It's a growing up process. There's nowhere else I've ever found that does what Delancey Street does, and in the way we do it. And, of course, we do it on our own. You'll find most of the residents here, we refer to it as ours, since we all of us have a share in this. And that's what I think makes it work and why we're successful.
The programs like Delancey Street cannot reform everyone who commits a criminal act. Unfortunately, there will always be an element of society making prisons a necessity. But in many instances, sending people to places like this do far more harm than good. So, do we continue to pump hundreds of millions of dollars into our prison system, a system which doesn't rehabilitate? Or do we develop community-based therapeutic programs like Delancey Street? Really, when you think about it, the choice is ours.
Yes. And you want to try to take a thing.